because when you're looking at a story yourself, to you it makes sense, everything connects because it's in your mind and you don't see the loopholes. But when someone else reads that story, they tell you, what about this, what happened to this one, what is she thinking at this moment, why does she think this, why does she say this, and that's when you start to think, this is missing. I thought, you know, everything flowed, but there are loopholes. So it's really important to be right and right and right.
All right, thank you very much, Aaron Chisa, for your question, and thank you, Ms. Amanda Karunji, for your time and for sharing your thoughts and insights with us. And we wish you the very best of luck in your writing career. We look forward to reading more and more of your stories and your work. Thank you. Good luck.
So much.
All right. All right. So, naturally, after work has been written, it only follows that it must be read. And Ibua's objectives are twofold: to ensure that Ugandan stories are written, but also to assure that those who write them will have local readership for their work. So, that being said, it gives me the greatest pleasure to invite one such person, and that is Miss Alesi Maria, who is our featured reader for this, our inaugural Ibua Lounge. You're welcome, Miss Alesi. Such a pleasure to have you here.
I'm also honored to be here.
All right. Okay, so Miss Alesi, as our featured reader, we would like first to know about you a little. Who are you? What is your history with books? Do you have a love affair with literature or not? Because certainly that is one of the reasons we invite you here. We know that you are head over heels in love with books and with literature. If I am mistaken, please correct me.
I think head over heels is a little good, but yes, I love to read. First, let me tell you about myself. Already said my name. I'm from Maracha. My bio is very short. I'm a Christian, I'm a feminist, and an African. I think that's enough. The rest doesn't really matter after that.
That's quite a lot, yeah?
Yes.
Sure.
So, first of all, I'm really excited to be here. I have great admiration for writers, because I think for you to take time off to put out what you think and what you feel is really a step of a certain amount of courage, because books are forever. People are going to read today, tomorrow, 100 years. So by the time you put it out, you've actually lent out a piece of yourself to the world. So I really hold them in high regard. I'm not a writer myself. I kind of write a few things, but I just keep them to myself a lot of times. So how did I get into reading? I guess growing up, I like to tell my friends that I'm overly colonized. I used to only like to read white literature. And I told me to read Chinua Achebe Ngugi wa Thiong'o, and rolling in my eyes. But my mom had a whole bookshelf of those books, because she's in love with African literature. But I preferred to read Jane Eyre. I was cracking a joke a few minutes back about Peter and Jane, you know, those little books we read when we were children?
Sure.
Yes.
Yeah.
I guess that's where it started from.
Okay. Right. So, just like Amanda mentioned a few minutes ago, this whole westernization and Europeanization of the mindset of the African child when they are first coming into contact with literature, how have you managed to break from that, if you have succeeded? Have you succeeded?
I haven't been very successful,
okay.
But I am not where I used to be.
Okay.
The fact that I'm here and I've read stories by Ugandans, as a matter of fact, should say a lot.
Okay.
But I think most importantly, life is about learning and unlearning. I still read a lot of books written about Africa or African stories written by people who are not Africans, mostly because it's nice to know how people perceive you out there.
Yes.
But also, more interestingly, I think it's exciting when you read a story in space most important thing about Amandla's book is that it creates it creates some kind of dichotomy, because she starts out by talking about a place where she had always been excited to go and visit, and then eventually her parents take her, the Sheila goes to visit, and then she tells us how she was excited she finally goes there, and then eventually she has to go there for school, and she gives a description of the space, not from what she experiences entirely as herself, but she gives you a little bit of the politics of the space, how the people feel, their culture, and all of that. So as you go deeper into the story, you sort of can put her personal experience into the space. It's something where I would say the personal is political. So either way, the story is able to morph in that particular space. I think it also gives light to the fact that it's not always there's stuff that goes on in the bigger bowl, if I should say.
Yeah.
Because then people are in class they're experiencing someone doesn't like someone because ABCD. But then you know that outside that context there's a lot of stuff happening in that particular country where she is. So
yes.
For me, I liked the beauty in that.
Okay.
But also because I could relate with it on a personal level. I did go to the university, I didn't have those people in class that I didn't like per se, because they always had a hand up.
Okay.
And had something to say all the time.
Sure.
When it's time for a lecture, then someone has a question and you're thinking, please, please, please help us. So that whole setting. And then also, a love story.
Yeah.
The fact that you don't just have a girl who's brilliant, but she's also able to experience all of these other things. Because in
her,
a world,
her life is not,
yeah, her life is not just,
yeah?
Yes, it's, she has a dynamic life. And at that level, for me, I think it's beautiful, because in a world today where a lot of times women who are at that level are looked at in such a way that they don't have a heart in there somewhere, they're just hardcore, is also a nice story. I also fear at some point that it also reinforces certain stereotypes about women. Things like you don't know what you want, because she's caught up between three people, except
right.
The other didn't bring his game in time, which at the end of the book, but
okay. When it was too late.
Yes, I also like the way she uses the words in the book, and I like the way she describes things, because then it brings life to the story.
Mm.
Yeah.
Ah, all right. Okay. I can hear the feminist view speaking very passionately, speaking very loudly, but I would want to know from that particular perspective what your opinion is regarding the treatment of the male character in the story. Did you feel the male characters in the story were the typical target of feminist activism? Were they chauvinistic, or were they the ideal male?
Yes.
From a feminist perspective.
Yes. In the book, Amandla goes to describe how Cain sits over in class and puts his arm over the chair and tries to rub a girl's shoulder, or whispers little nothings to women who just blush. And so, yes, they are presented as the stereotypical man of today. What we think is masculinity for society today.
Okay.
Because reckless
with emotion.
Yes, reckless with emotions. Also, because then the woman is presented a bit as a quote unquote damsel in distress.
Who needs rescuing?
Yeah.
So to speak. And women do not need rescuing. They don't. Okay. They'll be doing the rescuing themselves. Ah, all right. Okay, very well. How about some of the other stories, Ray? What are some of the common themes? What are some of the shared topographies of narrative that you find in these stories featured in your book?
One of the things I could tell from all the stories is that the authors love to describe.
Ah.
Yes. They will not let you go through the story without feeling where you are, right, from whether it is talking about the sun or talking about the earth or a table, they really make an effort. I'm sure if they could describe like atoms and they would go that far.
Sure.
But it's also a good thing because you don't want to be a part of a story in a space where you can't remember.
Mm.
So, but aside from Amandla's book, there are two books that, there are two short stories that really caught my heart.
Okay.
There was Charles Mumuza's story. It's the title is a short story.
Mm.
I was like, okay.
Yeah.
But anyway, it was such a beautiful story. I didn't know whether to be angry with him at the end of the day or to, because who kills the character there? Who does that? I'm just excited to hear, oh, and they live happily ever after. She died on the veranda.
Wow.
Yes, okay. and then also what I loved about Charles's story particularly was the fact that it gave this woman a certain sense of enlightenment, like she had freed herself from something, because here you are out of an abusive relationship of in-laws and people who have treated you badly, but it's within the same space, the same town. She doesn't have to move town like it's always portrayed that now I have to migrate to the next town, start my life. She starts her life in there, and she's able to put up with all of these things, and the fight in the market was just in
it. It was hilarious, yeah?
Yes.
Okay.
But then also, the saucepan battle.
Yes, the saucepan battle.
I think because almost every middle class or urban setup of a family has had maid drama. Like, I don't know if there's a home where you've had a maid and it has always been like
wow. Okay.
So and the thing I like about that story is the way it lifts it. It's the same house, but the experiences of people under the same roof are so different. It sort of made me reflect on the way I think and look at people in certain spaces. The thoughts of the nanny, I can't remember her name, the thoughts of the nanny and how she's thinking about the things her boss is telling her and how she has great admiration for what her boss is wearing, because she goes on to describe the clothes that her boss is wearing.
I think the name is Nakapande. Yes, I think so. My memory does not train me.
She's not called like Ashley. That's a joke.
Typical Ugandan name.
Yes. So for me, I felt like those two stories blew me away. But all in all, I think one reading these short stories has made me realize that it's okay. I don't have to wait to read only Ngozi's books because she's Nigerian and she's well known. There are beautiful stories happening within Uganda.
Yes.
There are beautiful people writing. There are amazing people writing amazing stuff in this country. And I guess Igbo is doing an amazing thing. Have I said that word right?
Yes, you are.
Yes. It's doing an amazing job. And yeah, I would clap for them.
Oh, okay. Yes. Thank you. Thank you so much, Alisi, Maria, for sharing your thoughts with us, for broadening our perspectives in that respect. And while you said you're not a writer at all and you just enjoy reading, we hope at some point in the future to read about your reading experience.
I'll just get somebody to author that for me.
All
right. The autobiography of Malcolm X as narrated to
Alex.
That would be like Maria as narrated.
All right. All right. Yes. Thank you. Yeah, and writing starts from narratives. If you have a voice, whether inside your head or moving through your vocal cords, then you are potentially a writer. So thank you for sharing your time with us, and we look forward to hearing more of your insights regarding Igbo and many other Ugandan literary works. Thank you very much.
Thank you.
Have a lovely evening. All right. Okay, so my thanks to those of you that have managed to stay with us this far, and our evening is still young. So at this point, I would like us to make a shift from the short story genre and move on to what the London Meet is most famous for. and that is the poetry. So at this point, it gives me a lot of honor and a lot of joy to welcome a poet of great renown, a gentleman who has been featured on many, many platforms talking poetry, talking issues around literature in this country and across the continent. His name is Aaron Chiza, and I would like to ask you to put your hands together. Yes, Aaron is from the great Chiga people of southwestern Uganda, and he's our poet tonight. We are more than happy to have him here. So, before Aaron goes into depth of telling us about himself and what his journey with poetry and with the London Meet has been thus, I would like to give us a jaribu, as the Swahili people would say, a little taste of what Aaron's mastery of words sounds like. And the person who will be doing that for us is Mr. Tobias Waswa. Mr. Waswa, you are more than welcome. We'll be hearing one of Aaron's poems from Waswa.
The poem is called Give Me Eden. You are the tree whose top leaves I have brushed, combed, and raked, but who's done what essence I'm meant to explore. You are a mountain whose slopes I have climbed and circled, but I'm yet to find the volcano that hosts the honeyed magma. That is why I repeat, give me the Eden. I have traveled your landscape somehow, but I haven't seen Eden. I know the rivers of Eden when I sight them. Give me Eden. I have grazed on the tasty pastures of your scarlet cheeks. I have felt the bending of your behind. I even draw it with eyes closed. Tasty is your vanguard, but Eden. Eden is the river. The rest are tributaries. The privilege of luck, my admission letter to your conservative company. But ripe is the time for my rifle to fire and my heart to shine in your pearly Eden. We owe it to us for the walls of your Jericho to fall to the army of love. I have loved and loved you, waited and waited for you. Let Jericho fall. Let it fall to the pounding army of love. What remains is Eden with its pristine fruits locked in your impenetrable wind. Thank you so much.
Thank you very much, Tobias, for that highly dramatized rendition of an already dramatic poem. What greater combination could we ask for? And the culprit is right before us. I use the word culprit, of course, very sparingly, because Aaron, as you will hear, is a practitioner of the law. So he would be very partial to certain statements. Mr. Chiza Aaron, you are welcome once again. Yes, it's such a great pleasure to have you here. It was an equally great pleasure listening to your words being given voice by Mr. Waswa. But before I delve into the watery depths of this Eden that you are certainly going to tell us about, I would like to ask you to introduce yourself to us more formally or more properly than I have done.
Well, Chiza Aaron is a married man. Married with two beautiful daughters. I am a lawyer by profession, human rights lawyer. I am a poet, groomed by the London Meet of Poets.
Thank you. Thank you very much. I think that pretty much gives us a very clear purview of who this multi-talented and multi-disciplinary actor in the literary and legal spaces of our land is. So, Mr. Kiza, let us begin by talking about this Eden before it passes out of the peak of our concentration. There are many biblical allusions to Eden, of course the garden of creation. But is that what is being referred to here?
I think some poems are very difficult to comment about, especially publicly. We're on Facebook, but we all know what happens in Eden. It is action packed. Things happen in Eden, it's not theory, and sweet things happen in Eden.
Wow, there are many apples and fruits.
Yeah, it's where you eat fruits, it's where. Of course, you have a big judgment after, but before judgment, it is heaven.
Wow.
Yeah.
Wow. He's an era, as hilarious as ever. And for me, reading this poem, reading a lot more of the poetry, I mean, you are a published poet. Your maiden collection, Pregnant Poets, was published some months ago. It has received a lot of critical acclaim. Many people who speak on matters of literature in Uganda have said that it was quite a heavyweight as far as debut poetry anthologies go. And it seems that the overarching device, if I may say, the overarching tool that you use, the literary tool of choice for you is humor and satire and irony and a play on the comic and the jocular. Is that something that comes natural to you? Because as you could tell, you had us in stitches just a few seconds ago, you know? Is it something that comes natural to you, or do you rehearse?
Well, no, there are no rehearsals. Effortless, spontaneous performance.
All right.
But I am a double-figured guy. Mm. Sometimes you guys meet a very quiet, humble, reserved, harmless error. Some other people know a rather more cantankerous and more jocular, sometimes cantankerous and serious, sometimes jocular, and meaning just to be ignored. And just think about. So, yeah, I am happy that I can combine both ends and transit from one to another, still effortlessly. So, when humor works, it is effortless. When it doesn't work, I mean, some people cannot do humor even after practicing for years. So I am happy to be one of those.
We may ask you to name names.
No. Yeah,
sure.
Yeah, but most of the times it is effortless. Discussions, but sometimes you deliberately go out of your way to create humor. In a poem, if you are writing, you can't say, it may come easily, but it's, many times it is also deliberate when it comes to writing, because you know, as you say, that humor is a device. And you know, Uganda, there is a need to democratize literature, and more so poetry, because initially it was stigmatized as something for, say, professors. But how do I talk to someone who is not even interested in it? Poetry, classically understood, but someone, for example, is just frying chapati.
Yeah,
yeah. How do I get him to read a book of poetry? So it must be simple, and it must be interesting to him. Sometimes I succeed, sometimes I don't.
Okay.
But when I succeed, people think I always succeed. I'm happy with that.
Okay. Sure, you're happy with the mindset.
With the impression they have created.
Okay, wow. Okay, thank you. Well, I still need to drive this humor point to its logical conclusion. Why, of all the diversity of devices available, apart from the fact that, of course, you alluded to its accessibility, but is it your considered opinion that the common man is unwilling or unable to consume grave and serious themes presented in a grave and serious way?
No. They do consume that kind of literature as long as it's compelling. Yeah, ultimately literature must be compelling because we as writers are competing with many things, including soaps, which are really not serious. But it's the reality. Very few people will sacrifice soaps or premiership football to read a poem.
Okay.
So there must be something that is inviting about a piece of writing to cause them to choose, because it's a choice. They are choosing your poem, your piece of writing over something, over even KB, whatever that means in English, but you know KB.
Yeah.
The Ghanaian audience, yeah, banter, yes. So things which are even unserious but are interesting, get me. So why should they not do that and do your poetry? And you know, as writers, the number one thing is we need to be read, we need to be heard, we need to be studied. Money is important, but for a writer, for a typical writer, even more satisfying is the readability.
Okay.
To go somewhere and someone tells you that, one time someone told me they were in a restaurant and someone chased a beggar and had written about beggars. He hands up something and that gentleman read the poem to the waiter, the waitress, and the waitress apologized that. I mean, the power of poetry for me, you can't quantify that for a writer.
Wow.
Yeah, you can't. Nothing is a monetary equivalent to what that brings to you. So for me, I write for fulfillment, and writing actually achieves that. So Ugandans are ready for even hideous, very melancholic literature as long as it's compelling, as long as it's up there, as long as it's good. I think the key is that writing should be good writing. It is easier to achieve good writing is humor, as for my case, maybe naturally. I mean, I write Elijah's work, but it is.
Elijah,
you know what it is, yes.
Your friend Elijah Bosch.
Yes, Elijah Bosch, but you know the kind of things he sometimes writes, except later, but he can. But so I like it, it's good, but sometimes, many times it's different. I admire, maybe I can't achieve it, maybe I can, but as long as it's good, it doesn't matter the technique you have employed.
Okay.
People will read. Yeah, but humor is one of those things which, if anyone, it shows you that I'm not a very talented writer, just that I know how to, I'm very practical that with humor, if it works, then people will do great.
Okay,
yeah, yeah.
All right, thank you. Now, I'd like to ask you a question similar to the one I posed to Amanda Karungi, who was our short story featured writer. And it is incidental that both of you are in the legal profession. What is it about the law and literature? Or is it purely accidental? You know? Because we're not deliberate about those choices.
We can't exhaust what that relationship is, but one of the starting answers is that because the law pays more than literature, ends up sucking the talent that is meant for the English department into law. People just being pursuing interests of money, of career, of what. So that is also there. But at a deeper level, those two go inside the law because they are all mediums of expression. You know, literature is freedom of expression. It is entertainment. And the law can do with a lot of that, you know. Literature defies law. It defies poetry. Law can complicate literature, but literature is like a liberator to law. Yeah, it liberates law if you can get the two. If you have read the judgment of someone who knows how to write, it's different. Uganda, we are really lacking in terms of judgment writing. But if you have read judgments of the likes of Denning, or even the letter of people like in Kenya, you can tell someone who has got it, that writing art in a judgment, and someone who is rare, you don't even want to finish two pages. It makes a difference. And even the precedent set in quotable phrases, there's a lot of interaction between law and poetry. Mm. Poetry is there to help law in a great deal. Both of them are expression mediums.
Okay.
They are expression mediums. Both are communicating. Law communicates a lot of authority. Poetry can communicate authority, but many other things. Mm. I think poetry is bigger than law.
Okay.
Yeah, although law is more formalistic, yeah.
All right. And now that you mentioned that natural kinship between the two disciplines of society and knowledge pursuit, I am reminded of a quote that one late British writer called Christopher Hitchens, a very controversial man, met relating to how writers influence legislation. His quote said, writers are the unacknowledged legislators of society. How true is that? Or untrue?
Well, I think there's some truth. Just start with writing at this basic. There's something called legal drafting, and it's no more than grammar. The active sense, where you put the parable, because in law, what a mistake in law is very costly and can be the difference between the liberty of a man and his incarceration. It can be the difference between losing billions and gaining them. Where a comma is pressed or where it misses in the law, it has grave consequences. Now, in writing, the consequences are into what people perceive. Again, the message changes sometimes. You remember where they are saying, go slow men at work, go
slow men at work.
I mean, those just as simple as that, you already see the role of writing in communication, and in also because law must be interpreted.
Okay.
Now, when people are interpreting, they are interpreting in accordance with the rules of writing. So, to that extent, yes, writers are legislators who are not acknowledged.
They should be acknowledged. All right. So now we need to watch a bit of activism for that. Okay. And thank you for making the bold statement that our justices and judges may need to be referred to in court at some point in the future.
Yeah.
So that they can receive some panel meeting regarding their literary skills. All right. So thank you very much, Kizza Aaron, for your time and for sharing those very, very wonderful thoughts with us. Look forward to reading more of the poetry. Kizza Aaron has a maiden poetry collection out, Pregnant Poems. It's available in leading bookstores across the country. Is it available on Amazon yet?
No,
not yet.
Which media?
Social media. All right. Yeah. Hopefully it will be available soon. All right. And before we close the chapter on Aaron temporarily, I'd like to welcome Mr. Waswa Tobias back to come and give us our second and final dose of Aaron the poet. Hopefully not Aaron the lawyer. We can find that one in a courtroom sometime soon. So Mr. Tobias, you're more than welcome. So, yeah.
Aaron the poet. Who remembers like me? Of the times we played on the veranda, a little dark outside with giggles and noises, how we attacked basins of H2O and irrigated ourselves, irregularly leaving some water-fasting islands on our bodies. But there had to be another round upon the parent judge, handing down a chilling verdict. Again, you haven't paid properly. Should you say you are still a child? Sometimes a hot twah made a lightning fist to my back as I cowered back to the veranda for a bolder offensive on the snow in the hostile basin. Who remembers that?
Thank you very much for that. All right. Okay, so at this this point, I welcome Mr. Robert Sempande to come in and usher us into a different terrain of poetry. Thank you, Robert. You're welcome.
Thank you, too.
All right.
The Retarded Thoughts of a Working Man by Elijah Boji. What can a man's reward be if not money, if not the full bellies of his children, if not knowledge acquired in institutions built by those society deems successful? Oh, children of my younger days, and you who later in the grace of my age have come, woe upon you, woe unto your dreams and all your toil. The days have been long, and now darkness looms nearer for me. Don't ever ask a father what he has achieved, nor him who has sworn to instruct the nation's young. What direction do winds blow if one who blows them knows not the purpose to these winds? Children are winds, simply sweeping over the plains of the world, till one channels them into pipes or overturning turbines to yield power for the powerless nation. Once, some wise man said, did he say, or are these my insolent thoughts? He said that knowledge is but a waste if only on the shelves it sits, like pages collecting dust. For I have taught many, but failure has gutted me like wrinkles on my wife's face. I have taught and taught and taught. Chalk has turned my hair gray, and its white powder has coated my beard permanently. And what have I achieved, O children of my youth? Ask me, ask your father of his achievements. Rugged roads on the once beautiful face of a wife are my eyes' rewards. And for my ears, her nagging voice about the empty sacks of food. A slave's reward is a bed of straws, a cold plate of beans, and children to slave on when he is gone. I am the slave, and our Uganda wields the whip.
Titled Dear Pauper by Remy Bagenda. Dear Pauper, guilt so whelms that I crave not feel or listen to myself think of your slim mat soul, fallen like a desert tree between the cold deserted streets. But while at the set of the day's sun I sat, your deplorable misery filled my heart, and yet trapped still I remained with less empathy at heart. In you, albeit, resides an eternal feature. Valor. That gilded character I already love, or rather admire. You see, when my hard and slim stock they seized, at once your tread I was impelled to admire. But courage hastily seized. I hate to believe when they say that none on earth is given without labor, because that then makes yours a tread much better than mine. Who on the guarded streets has to sway in hope of meeting labor's favor? Always with undying envy, yours, Hustler.
Good evening, Chibone Agnes. The Happy One by Gom Emmanuel. The Germans made him, so it was said, to be efficient, smooth, and fast. And so, at New Year's tolling stroke, he said his grace for all the year, to save his time and God's apace. He got so good at maths, they say, through all the calculations done, computing range from class to mess and speed to get him there fast. Tingling the ring upon the ground of Nyanzi's secret spoon and heat, and off he flies toward the mess 10 crucial seconds before the gong. Wide open bursts the dining door like fleeing sentry at death's approach. And now, lo, the boy, shaking, stands before the counter, hands outstretched. Lovingly, the chefs pile his plate, blessed in time for their foremost fun. Oh, could you have seen him, beaming, joy upon his features written? Could you have glimpsed him, chuckling, sat, steaming posho mounds inhaling and gobbling up his wibbled beans? You would have known an angel's joy. And we who know and know him well shall smile politely, nothing say, about a boy who foraged oft, eating oat he chanced across, who, unknowing, one omened night did gulp down hunger for a crumb. Till now, vast deserts, famines, droughts, gripe and growl in his paunch all day.
My name is Avaro Aki, and I'm reading a poem called When Breath Becomes Air by Ashalom Derek. And with screams, beds squeak, sheets shift, their wrinkles dunk with tears, those of entrance and exit. That we come first with a moan, a groan or a cry, then leave only when breath becomes air. When last we sigh.
Thank you very much. Yes, I think I can. give the gratitude to the rest of your co-readers. You have been amazing voices. Your ability to translate the thoughts, the emotions, the depth of feeling that each of the poems contains has been very, very awe-inspiring for you. And I'm sure the audience in here at the library and watching us across the nation, across the internet, watching world, would agree. But before I mention you out, before we let you go for the evening, I would want you to tell me what your experience with the art of reading poetry aloud has been. Is it something that you have done for a while? Is it something that is new to you? Is it something that you find resonates with you as a person?
The art of performing poetry in general, not just reading it, is something that I've done for a while under the Lantern Meter of Poets in the various productions that we've had. It's something that's thrilling, I think, to me. It's there's something about standing in front of people and performing or bringing to life words that are originally on paper or words that were originally in somebody's mind and giving it a voice.
Is it like a way of participating in the creative process?
It definitely is. I mean, if there were no people like me to perform these works, there wouldn't be... some people would definitely be bored. There are people who didn't want to read, to sit down and read. Yeah. So we bring action to the words that have been put down. We bring those words, basically we give them life, I think. You know, I'm not God, but I do give life to these words that ideally did not have life before.
Okay.
I'm missing.
Yeah. Wow, and a brilliant job you've done. Yourself, Robert, Tobias, Latifa, and Achela. I think they do deserve another hand clap from us. And as you mentioned, you've been part of the Lantern Meter for 1, 5, 6, 7?
A little over 4 years.
All right, okay. And what has your experience with Fair Journey been for you like?
It's been a roller coaster ride. Yes, ups, downs, paddles, and triumphs, and failures, and triumphs again. It's been fantastic. I love it. I have learned a lot. There are things that I didn't know I could do that I learned how to do on the job. Producing, directing, those are things that I learned on the job, which is an amazing thing. So it's been mind-opening. It's been an amazing journey.
All right, thank you. Thank you very much, Aki, Bahu. And we look forward to hearing more of your voicing and your reading. And you're a poet yourself, aren't you?
Yes, I am. Although my works are still in the closet, they will come out.
They will. Yes, we will hold you to your words.
I have a thank number you. Of things in my computer that I have not let anybody read. So
one day soon. All right, thank you very much, Aki. Look forward to that. It was nice sharing your company this evening. Yes. All right. You too. All right, so gentlemen and ladies, this brings us to the end. What I hope has been an engaging and exciting and art-enriching, art-enhancing evening. From myself as a moderator from the Lantern Meet of Poets, we would like to ask that you continue loving African literature, you continue reading African literature, and specifically because the Lantern Meet of Poets is a team of Ugandan art enthusiasts. It is to the Ugandan public, to the Ugandan reading audience that we speak, and say, please visit us at www.lantonmeet.com, which is our central store for all the literary work we'll be putting out from today onwards. BUA as a literary journal, has very, very many up and coming initiatives, and we assure you that the quality, the depth, and the breadth of all that work shall be to your liking. And the Ibua team has been hard at work in the kitchen, ensuring that the literary epoch of Africa's writers is restored to its former glory. They consider themselves, I am sure, heirs to great names such as Uganda's Okot Pabitek, Nigeria's Soyinka Nachebe, Sudan's Lo Leong, and many other writers across the continent. And for them, this is a task as noble as it is monumental. We also would like, of course, to express our gratitude to the partners who have made this evening possible, the Library of the Uganda Society here at the National Museum of Uganda, which has availed us this most ideal of spaces in which to have a conversation on things literature. And we also would like to thank African Studies Bookstore for availing us with the wonderful book covers that you can see in the background, and books, of course. And we ask that you visit them at www.theafricanstudiesbookstore.com online and shop, browse through their collection, and buy a book of your choice. They also have a physical collection here at the Uganda Society Library off Kira Road, just next to Chitande, at the premises of the Uganda Museum. And finally, the team of technological actors, if I may say, who have made this webcast possible, 8 Media, Eugene Kavuma, and your team, thank you very much for bringing the Lantern Meet to the world. Finally, to our audience here in the studio and outside, thank you very much for being as indulgent, as interested in these things as you have been. We hope to see you again very soon. Thank you.